Hi, I'm Mary Poplin, and today I want to show you a little bit about PowerMesh and Roto. A lot of times, Mocha users will think that PowerMesh is really good for inserts and not much else, but actually PowerMesh is really powerful for rotoscoping. And in this tutorial, I will show you how to take this tattoo and color it using PowerMesh Roto. So let's get started and deep dive into how to do rotoscoping with PowerMesh. So the first thing I need to do is select my footage, go to Effect, and then Boris Effects Mocha, and select Mocha Pro. This will bring up my plugin interface, and if I hit the Launch Mocha button, I will launch Mocha directly from my timeline. Now, if I play this shot, you can see that I've got a lot of occlusions over the area that I need to track with PowerMesh. Well, that's kind of a pain to do. So what I have to do is I have to apply what's called holdout shapes over these hands so that I don't track the motion of the hands while I'm also tracking my PowerMesh subplanar track. I tend to use X-splines for rotoscoping. We have Beziers down here, but X-splines are going to be your better tool for rotoscoping inside of Mocha. So let's take a shape and draw a big shape right around these hands here, and another large shape over these hands here. Now, why am I drawing a large shape? One of the reasons I'm drawing a large shape is because you can see there's a lot of data around these hands that aren't the hands that would still mess up my track. So this shadow can be considered an occlusion to the track, and any of the fingers and any of the motion blur from the hands would also be an occlusion to the track. So we're going to track both of these. I'm going to call this right hand and left hand. We're going to track translation, scale, rotation, and shear, but not perspective. And we're going to hit track forwards. I don't like to use perspective when I'm tracking things like hands or organic roto, because when you're tracking organic roto and you use perspective and the object's moving quite a bit, sometimes your surface can go behind the camera and you'll get an error. Shear is all I need for this. I don't mind that the shapes are changing over time because I'm just going to correct the roto shape once my track is complete. All right, once my track is complete, I can start to adjust my shapes. So I can see that I need to pull this shape over here, grab these fingers, and grab a little bit of these fingers. What I want to make sure of is I want to make sure that my shadow is inside of my shape at all times, and so is my arm. Once that hand is complete, we can move to the other hand. And with just a few keyframes, we have contained those hands into a nice holdout shape with a lot of leeway. From here, I can start to draw a shape around the area that I want to PowerMesh track, which would be this tattoo. Notice how I'm staying inside the edges of the body. That's because if the body turns, I want to make sure that I have an accurate track for the whole body. We're going to turn on perspective and mesh warp, and you can see that it generates a mesh automatically. I want a uniform mesh warp, and I'd like it to be a little bit larger. The reason I went with a larger mesh is because I'm just doing rotoscoping for this. I don't need super fine detail, and also I would like this to track quicker. I'm going to call this face track, drag it underneath my right hand and my left hand, and what that means is that's now held out of my track while we track our PowerMesh. You can see that we're only going to be tracking this. As the hands move over, they're held out. I'll turn the gears off for my right and left hand because I don't want to track them anymore, and we'll focus on tracking this background. I hit track forwards. This will track at a couple of frames per second, and I've sped this up so that you don't have to sit through it. If we lose the track, we can always correct the track. So here in the middle, I feel like we're losing a little bit of the track. We can do one of two things. We can either use the edit mesh to pull our problem points apart and try to animate over time how they change. Or we can simply delete the problem points and let the rest of the power mesh drive our future roto. I'm going to correct these power mesh points, and now I can start linking shapes to this track. We're going to turn all of our layers off, and I'm going to make a new layer for this skin on this face here. I'm using my X-spline tools. I'm going to relax for a curve so I get a nice shape. I'm going to call this face roto, and I'm going to link that to face track. And now my roto will move along with my face. If there's any spot where the roto is not warping correctly because of my holdout mats, I'll just correct my shape the same way I would with any other bit of roto inside of Mocha. I'll do the same thing for the neck area as well. I'm going to keep building up these shapes over time, separating out an eye shape, a mouth shape, a little shape for the shadow under the face, a necklace shape, some of these background wind-blown shapes, and the horns. And I'll use these to color in this tattoo. They don't have to be perfect because I'm going to feather them a little bit, but they do need to be close. Now, the other thing that I have to do to finish this shot is I have to rotoscope the hands. Rotoscoping hands is a little bit tricky. We'll draw a shape around our fingers. And honestly, these fingers are probably warping a little bit too much to use things like the power mesh for the roto for the fingers. So I will just have to do them by hand. We'll call this three fingers and go ahead and track that forwards using only shear. When I'm doing rotoscoping on things like hands, I tend to only use shear and not perspective. Okay, so notice when I rotoscoped these three fingers together, the pinky finger split apart. And that might be a good argument for splitting the pinky into its own separate shape. But I can also just pull this point in to roto that. It really just depends on how many keyframes you want to make and what kind of time frame you're running on. In general, it is good to split up parts based on their movement. So once your track is complete, you can start to adjust your keyframes over time. And what this adjustment will do is it will animate between the track and your keyframes so that you end up with a smooth, lovely animation for your rotoscoping with very few keyframes, okay? Because we're driving everything along with a Mocha track. Now, I am not going to make you sit through me rotoscoping these fingers, but I will say I did use Power Mesh for one shape, which was the arm over here. And that saved me a lot of keyframes. But things like individual fingers definitely required a whole lot more keyframes. So I just want to be realistic about what I'm showing you. This kind of rotoscoping takes time and does need to be split up. So in the case of the right hand over here, which I guess is the guy's left hand, but the right hand side hand, This is split up into 1, 2, 3, 4 fingers, the hand, and the arm. This shape over here is split into 3 fingers, and you can see I have a lot of keyframes. Especially where the pinky splits off. And then I did the pointer finger separately in order to get my fingers back over the top. So the takeaway for Roto is that you need to split everything up by movement groups. And if you've got something like a hand where the fingers are all moving individually, then yes, those fingers do need to be individually rotoscoped, or you're going to run into a lot of trouble. I want to show you one more thing, which is the thumb. And you can see the thumb I animate off screen. So here's my last good keyframe of the thumb. I made a keyframe there. And then I animated this thumb off the screen, even though I trimmed the layer inside of Mocha. So if you animate the shapes off the view screen, you end up with shapes that will export to whatever host and also can be animated back onto the screen at any time. So that's a good roto tip. Another cool thing that you can use for rotoscoping to speed things up is hitting Alt S for snap. And Mocha will snap points to edges it can find. This can be really handy when you're rotoscoping and you want to get done quickly. Now all I have to do is save and close Mocha and go back to After Effects. Once we've created all our shapes, we can apply them. And there's a couple of different ways we can apply them. So let's talk about how to color this in using all the roto shapes that we made. It's a lot like painting in the lines in MS Paint. What we'll do is we'll duplicate our Mocha project and our original footage. And we'll want to do this per color. So right here, if I want to turn this face a color, I'll go to Fill. And we're going to fill this with a color. Let's fill it with a blue for now. And turn it on. Let's make our blending mode Hue. And that will change the hue of everything in the shot because we haven't used a shape to find the edges. So that means we need to apply a shape to the edges. We're going to go to Matte, Visible Layers, and I'm going to turn on my face layer by selecting the eye and hitting OK. Now I hit Create AE Masks, and that will create a shape where my face roto is. So now inside of my masks, Mocha has created a native AE mask for me, and I'm going to give it a feather of about 25 pixels, maybe 50. And now I have color on my tattoo. In my original shot, I made his face green, and I feathered about 200 pixels at the edges to make it sort of fade out the way that tattoos tend to fade out. Next, I added some blue shapes using color and made these wisps and the cheek shadow blue. Next, I added some yellow for his horns and whatever this necklace is, and a little bit to his cheeks to give a highlight and also to continue color through the shot, because when you're painting things, you want to repeat some of the colors across the board. Next, I used overlay to add some red to the darkest parts of his eye, and I used a color red with a little bit of opacity to blend this back over the top. So basically, I colored in his mouth and eyes the same way because they're both red. Next, I multiplied the lines back over the top by using the face shape and just the skin color. And you can see, if we turn this to normal, that we've just made it grayscale by taking all of the saturation out of it. And when we apply multiply, it puts the lines back in for us. But what it tends to do is it doesn't color what we've just done here. I added a little bit of a soft light to get some of the lighting back with a little bit of a blur. And then I took all of the tattoo ink color and blended it in using darken so that we get some of the original color back in our lines. And I just used levels to darken the darks. Next, I used white and set that to hue to desaturate the eyes and teeth so that they wouldn't be skin color. Obviously, white has no color, so hue takes it more to grayscale. And then I rotoscoped the fingers back over the top. So you can see the fingers are applied with masks, or we can use apply mat to apply the fingers as well. I've set all the masks to none because I wanted to show you what the masks looked like in After Effects. But for these fingers, the reason I'm using apply mat is because in Mocha Pro, you can add motion blur to your shapes to get motion blur for free based on the tracking data. So my shapes are actually being nicely added back over the top, but with the apply mat and a little 5-pixel feather. Then, because I felt like this was just a little too garish and a little too saturated, I added the original layer back over the top at about 30%. And that puts everything right back into the same lighting, blends it with the original a little bit, gives me a little bit of skin color to the eyes, because it is on skin, ultimately, and makes it feel like it belongs in the shot. So here's the original before I blended the top back over, and here's the top blended back over. So here's your before, and there's your after. You can use Mocha Pro in any host that we support, which is to say you can use it in After Effects, Nuke, Fusion. You can use it in Flame. You can use it in Avid and Premiere. And your ability to composite these colors over an original piece of footage will depend on what is available inside of the host of your choice. To give you a realistic timeline, this shot took about a day and a half, with most of that time being spent on rotoscoping, especially the hands. But Mocha Pro still takes a lot of the pain out of rotoscoping, allowing you, the artist, to work faster and smarter and get your shot done on time. If you have any questions, you can find us on www.borisfx.com, where you can find more information on our forums, on free training, and our tutorials.